It's time now for Teen Christian Ministries Live with your hosts, Larry Roy and Leslie Lamb. Larry and Leslie are in the studio. Let's join them now for TCM Live.
Hi, guys. Good evening. As you can tell, we're doing things a little bit differently today. It's just me. Larry is out of town, but I do have a special guest for us. We have Halen Dowdy, and she is with us, and we are going to be doing a series, a two-part series, called Overcoming Addiction, the Endless Road to Recovery. So we're really excited about that. Thank you so much for coming, Halen.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Well, we're excited to have you. And, you know, we were talking before the show about just some statistics that they say about addiction specifically. And just a couple of those statistics that I found very interesting. And one of them is that illicit drug use in America has been increasing.
I'm not surprised.
I'm not surprised either. What would you think would be a reason for that?
I think drugs are becoming a lot more popular amongst younger people. Mm-hmm. I think kids nowadays are really trying to grow up a lot faster, and I think drugs are a part of that.
Right, right. And we talked about the role of drugs in escaping, you know, being able to medicate those pains and things like that. And you see more and more kids that are dealing with pain, mm-hmm. maybe even more so than my generation, I think.
Absolutely. I think for a lot of people, it's an escape from reality, or it's a way to deal with pain and struggle and something else maybe to focus your time and your energy on.
Right, exactly. And it says that most people use drugs for the first time when they are teenagers.
Absolutely.
And I know that that's true in your case.
Yes, and very much so.
When we have an interview with Todd Slesher, he will be our next guest, that's true in his case as well. And we've heard countless stories of kids getting involved in it as teenagers, mm-hmm. either young teenagers or older teenagers. But they say also in these statistics that non-medical use of the prescription drugs or over-the-counter drugs is the significant part of teen drug problems.
Definitely. I think that particularly is something that maybe teens can get their hands on easier.
Right.
Because some of their friends might have been prescribed them. And I know from personal experience that sometimes when people get put on these medications, there's a rebellion factor of I'm not going to take it,
right.
which only makes them more available to teens who want to abuse them.
Right. And that's true. And I just had surgery myself, and I kind of had that same, you know, like I'm only going to take what I need when I need. And so I do have a stash, but I need to make sure that, you know, my kids don't get into that or anything
right.
like that. So that's a great point to make, because mm-hmm. there could be somebody out there listening who is a grandparent or a parent, and they're like, wow, I really do have a stash. Maybe I need to guard that.
Right.
So
we need to make it less accessible, I think. A little bit harder to get a hold of, maybe. And
right.
maybe that'll deter some people, hopefully.
Yeah hopefully. I really hope so. Well, I thank you so much for coming and sharing your testimony with us. And one thing that we always say here is you're not alone. And so we know that someone watching either is struggling with addiction, has struggled with addiction, or has a loved one that is struggling with addiction. And so you sharing your story is going to help them, I truly believe, encourage them to either break that cycle or to have hope and encourage the person who's in that cycle.
I hope so. I hope that it does. I hope that I can demonstrate to people that we don't have to be ashamed of the mistakes that we made. I mean, I've made some questionable decisions in my life, but they don't define me anymore. That's not who I am, and that's not how I have to live. And it's beyond time to own up to the things that I've done and that everyone, you know, has done. And it takes the power away from it. It makes
right.
it mean less once I take control of it and I decide it's happened, it's over, and maybe I can help someone else from my mistakes.
That is so important. And I truly believe that that is part of the process of healing, is being able to use your hurt and your mm-hmm. victimization and your pain to assist someone else get through theirs. Well, one of the first questions that I thought about is, you know, our lives are made up of memories, both good and bad. And What would you say is your first memory?
Well, I'm not sure exactly my first memory, mm-hmm. but I do remember being lonely mm-hmm. a lot as a child. I had a really hard time making friends and interacting with people. And I remember I used to watch people a lot and watch their relationships and wonder why friendship came so easily to some people, but it seemed much more difficult for me.
Right.
So I did spend a lot of time alone, which was sad. You know, it's sad for a child to be yeah. lonely.
Right.
So I did struggle with that some.
Were you an only child?
Yes, I have a half brother who's quite a bit older than me, so I did grow up as an only child.
Right, and that makes a difference too, not having that
right.
sibling to kind mm-hmm. of see things through and
exactly.
with. Yeah. Well, would you say that you had a normal childhood?
Well, my childhood wasn't perfect by any means, but I suppose by today's standards, it was fairly typical. Mm-hmm. My parents separated when I was quite young, and I struggled with that for a long time, different issues that arose from that. And I did have a hard time with it. I mean, I spent a lot of my life as an outcast, alone. I dealt with a lot of personal issues that I don't think many people understood. And because of that, I felt like a lot of people thought that I was weird.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of helped to isolate me from other people.
Yeah. Well, what would you say, there was a moment maybe perhaps, I don't know, that you realized maybe something's wrong or maybe I need to do something to make myself feel better or to, you know, whatever that may be.
Right. I did have that moment. I realized that something was wrong when I was about 17.
Mm-hmm.
I had just come out of a very unhealthy relationship, and something just didn't feel right about me anymore. The way that I was acting, the way that I was thinking and feeling just wasn't where I wanted it to be, and it wasn't really what I was accustomed to.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to the doctor, and it was then that I was diagnosed with anxiety and depression and bipolar disorder.
Wow.
So
those are some pretty significant
they are.
Diagnoses. So from there, what happened?
Well, my life changed drastically with that diagnosis. Suddenly, I was this broken person with all of these problems, and I wondered, how could anyone love me? Or how could I even love myself mm-hmm. with all of these things that were wrong with me? And that's how I looked at them for a long time, like there was something wrong with me. But as I've come to terms with it, I'm learning more and more every day that that's not the case. I thought for quite some time that the doctor was wrong and that I was fine. I spent a lot of time in denial. And eventually I stopped taking the medications that he had prescribed for me. And that made a huge difference because now I had to deal with all of these symptoms and these issues that I faced completely unmedicated, completely alone. And that's when I decided I was going to turn to drugs with the help of some people who I thought were my friends.
Mm-hmm. And that's kind of normal a lot of times mm-hmm. with drug use and drug abuse, and it begins with someone else introducing it to you and a sense of vulnerability there. You think, oh, these are my friends, we're going to mm-hmm. do this together, they're not going to hurt me, but they're broken people too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happened in my case. Oddly enough, I had told my friends for weeks prior to me actually trying these things for the first time that I didn't think that it was a good idea. You know, I sat back for 2 or 3 weeks and watched them do it
mm-hmm.
and said, no, I don't think that's for me. But eventually I got to this point where I was so vulnerable and I was just open to any option mm-hmm. of escape.
Mm-hmm.
And it took a little bit of convincing, but once I tried it, that was it.
So do you think that maybe initially not wanting to do it, but then doing it was kind of your sense of maybe taking back control, maybe because you didn't feel like you had control of your own emotions and things, all those things that you were diagnosed with. Maybe doing drugs was kind of a way of getting that into control. And they say that a lot of times, in order to feel like we have a sense of control, people will get involved with destructive habits. So besides drugs, were there any other destructive habits that you found yourself, you know, doing?
Absolutely. The destructive habits, though, came more or less as a side effect of the drugs. Mm. That was really the core of the problem. They took over my life, and I mean every aspect of my life. I lost friends, family, I threw my future away. Like, everything was lost to these drugs. Mm. And I was spending time with these people who I thought were my friends but were not. I was in college at the time, and I decided I was going to skip classes and not go anymore. I spent a lot of time in bars and just places that I really didn't need to be at freshly 18 years old.
Right.
You know, but it all kind of started to spiral out of control, and I thought I had it under control for a while. But it just became more and more clear to me that the drugs really were controlling me.
Yeah, and that's what a lot of kids and adults, too, don't understand, is that eventually they become, the drug becomes the so-called God that begins to control what they want and what they need. And I'm just curious, when you were in that time, did you realize that you were losing your family? Did you realize that you were losing those friends and those loved ones, or did you feel like they just didn't understand you and you were better off without them?
I definitely felt like they didn't understand me. A lot of people in my life were trying to help me at the time. Of course, not many people really knew what was actually going on in my life, but they could see changes in mm-hmm. me. They could see me becoming this different person, this angry, elusive person, who just had a lot of resentment towards people and the world in general.
Right.
And I was really starting to resent the people who were trying to help me. I thought they were trying to control me, and I was adamant that I knew what was best for me.
Right.
And that I had everything completely under control and no one needed to worry about me.
Right.
But I did slowly but surely push all of these people away because I wouldn't let them in. Or I would lash out at them when they would try to help me. And it just became more and more of a lonely, really, existence.
Right. And would you say that that was kind of cyclical? So as it became more and more lonely, maybe you found yourself more and more dependent on the drugs to escape that loneliness.
Definitely. I mean, that it got to a certain point where that was all that I had in life. I mean, I had people that I would use with, mm-hmm. But they weren't my friends by
right.
any means.
Right.
I had different places that I would go, but not my house, not my home.
Right.
I didn't have a home
right.
for myself anymore. I had these places that I spent time, and that was really it. And I didn't have friends or family. I had these people that I spent time with, and
right.
that was it. All that there really was that was left was the drugs.
Yeah.
That's what got me up in the morning. That's what got me through the day, and that's all that I knew, really. That was the only focus in my life, was using and then getting, and then using and getting.
Well, I know that there are probably some teen girls out there right now who are struggling with that and maybe feeling like they're okay right now. But I know, just from my own past and my own experience, that being a female, being a girl, mm-hmm. puts you at greater risk for certain things that maybe a guy who's addicted to drugs and is caught in addiction may not, and I'm going to say may not, because I truly believe that some young men are taken advantage of in the same way. But, you know, what would you say to them, to the girls that, you know, maybe they don't realize what they're missing or what's going to happen when they take the drugs? Could you just kind of like walk us through the initial feeling and then how you begin to feel?
Right. Well, it starts with yourself, really. When you take these drugs of any kind, I mean, it truly doesn't matter, any mind-altering substance. It can even be alcohol, and sometimes we don't consider that a drug, but really it is.
Right.
Your inhibitions are lowered. You are more vulnerable to being hurt because your guard is down. And you might not even realize what things are are happening to you, because you lose sense of reality, right. And you don't even sometimes know what's going on anymore. Some of these drugs make you sleepy. Some things will make you pass out, and things can happen. But really, there's a whole just myriad of terrible things that can happen to girls when our guard is down, and especially when people are aware that your guard is down, and they know that you're vulnerable. They know that you might not remember this the next day. And you have to take into account as well the people that are there with you, because they too are not themselves on these substances. They're not the friend that you go to school with anymore. Their mind has been changed. Their opinions, their beliefs, their desires have changed. And you don't know who they are anymore or what they're capable of.
That is a powerful statement. That truly is, because you're no longer safe, not only in who you are, but who you're around, because everyone changes. That is good to know and good to remember. Well, I remember when you were first telling us about your testimony, and you were talking, and you said something that I found very powerful. You said that there was a point where you realized, I have to work to be better. So can you kind of explain that?
Absolutely. It took real effort on my part to get better. Mm-hmm. It took a lot of trying and a lot of failing to get through this addiction. I spent a lot of time on one substance, and then I would get clean off of it, and I thought that I was doing better, but I would immediately get addicted to something else. And I just kind of cycled through these substances and spent a little time with this and a little time on that.
Right.
And it took a lot of trying to actually get over this. And it took time to accept it, even, that I had this problem, this addiction. And once I accepted it, that wasn't even the start of the healing.
Right.
That was just, in some ways, more depressing because I realized that I was a victim to these substances and that they controlled me.
Right.
And it took a lot of time for me to build up the strength and the courage to actually reach out and ask for help. And eventually, I did have people surrounding me who were there to help and lend a hand. But at the end of the day, it was still my struggle. I had to want it, and I had to work for it.
Right. And that's one thing that we need to realize, is it truly is a journey. It's a journey of recovery. It's a journey of health back to that state of being okay again and no longer addicted. I know that my cousin struggled with addiction for a really long time, and I don't know all the drugs that she was taking, but I know at one point she was on heroin, and withdrawal symptoms were crazy, but she came to Christ, and years later, she came to Christ, and eventually, slowly, like you said, one habit after the other was broken. It wasn't one grand gesture, and her life completely changed, and I remember we had gone to dinner or something, and she was outside and she was smoking, and someone had walked by, someone who was a part of the church that I knew, and they just dismissed her, just like, I can't believe you're out here smoking and we go to church together. And there was that part of me, you know, that protector part that wanted to say, yeah, but you don't know what she, you know, I mean, just because she's smoking a cigarette, it could be so much worse. It has been so much worse, because it is a journey, and cigarettes is one of her last hold on to something things, and she's trying, but it is a journey. And just because someone has a vice now, we as Christians, we need to be careful that we're not looking down on them, because we don't know how far they've come to just be smoking.
Right.
And we really need to be careful of the judgments that we make anyway, because none of us know the other story or what hell they may be living through that we can't see.
Oh, no, I understand. I, unfortunately, am a smoker myself, and I do get that. Like, people almost chastise me for it, you know, or look down on me because I have, you know, this addiction. And it is an addiction, just like all of the others that I've dealt with.
Right.
But relatively, how far that I've come, it's tremendous that that's all that I'm doing anymore.
Right.
It's really a testament to how far I've actually come. And I think you're absolutely right. For someone to look down on someone for what they do without knowing what they have done or what they've been through, is more than judgmental. I mean, it's disheartening, really, yeah. to see people treat each other like that.
You're right. You're right. And I don't think that that's the way God would have us treat, because I know he sees us uniquely and he sees us individually. And he saw Halen then and he sees Halen now. And he's proud of how far you've come. So I don't believe he's looking in disgust at you every time you smoke a cigarette.
Yeah, I don't think so. But it is something that I will continue to struggle with. And hopefully one day I'll overcome that as well.
Right.
But that's kind of the point of recovery, is right. that it is an endless journey. It's never, you're never actually done.
Right.
You know, I will always be this addict. I will always have these addictions to things. It's just whether or not I choose to indulge them.
Yeah.
And for the drugs, I don't.
Right.
But that's not to say that it's not still a struggle for me.
Right.
I mean, I have to take certain precautions in my life. I don't put myself in situations where these things are going to be available. I don't associate with people who use them, because I know that it's still a struggle for me. And to see it somewhere, to have it offered to me, I'm not sure whether or not I can still adamantly deny it and say,
right.
no, I'm better. Because it really does depend on what state you're in at a certain time and where you're at in life,
right.
how vulnerable you are to these things, and how difficult it can be to say no.
Right. And that's so important that they realize it really has to be a life change.
Mm-hmm.
You really have to change. And it's hard. And you've talked about that. But it's realizing I have to do this for me, because I have to be healthier. And God wants you to do that, because he wants you to be healthy. And I know that there's a tattoo on your arm, which I love. And it says, "We accept the love we think we deserve," which is a quote from The Perks of Being a Wallflower, which is great, a great book that kind of walks through a lot of your testimony as well as some of my testimony. So how do you think that quote, because obviously it represents you, or you wouldn't have it on you.
Exactly.
How do you think that quote represents your story?
That quote really means everything to me. It's more or less my life story in one little sentence. And it seems so simple, but it's such a powerful statement.
Yeah.
We accept the love we think we deserve. And for a long time, I accepted bad treatment from people. I let people treat me badly for a long time, because I thought that's what I deserved. I thought that I was this broken person, and that I would never be whole, and I would never be normal. And so I just deserved this lesser treatment, and I deserved to be talked to a certain way and treated a certain way and used in certain ways.
Right.
But it took a lot of growth on my part for me to accept myself for who I am and learn to love myself despite the flaws that I have, and see those flaws not as defects, but as just marks that make me who I am.
Right.
They're not something that's wrong with me. They're just something about me.
Yes.
And it doesn't have to be negative. And finally, I've come to terms with that, and I can love myself again, which means that I can decide what's acceptable for me in my life. I get to decide what I will accept and what I won't. And that's a huge step.
That is a huge step. And it's a huge step in healing process, and also in relating to other people. One thing that we find often is when you've been extended grace and healing, it's a lot easier to extend that to others. You know, had you not walked through this, you might be the one judging the person outside the coffee shop smoking, because the way we see life a lot of times is through the lenses of our own experience. And so as painful as these experiences can be, and I know in my own life, as painful as the experiences that I've had to face were, I wouldn't change it, because it's made me who I am, and it has allowed me to be a help to so many other people that felt like they were alone. And so you coming and sharing your testimony here, I truly believe is important. And it's saying, you know, not only are you worth the love, but you're sharing the love to other people because you've received the love finally for yourself.
Exactly. And there have been positive things that have come out of my struggle that have made it all really worth it.
Mm-hmm.
I've had people in my life that have also struggled with addiction that prior to my experience, I judged them and didn't allow them to be a part of my life because of the mistakes that they had made. And it took me making almost the same mistakes to realize what power an addiction can have over you and how it can change you.
Yeah.
And it can truly change everything about you. So because of that, I've made amends with people and I've let more people into my life. And so I have this big circle of love now. And I also met the love of my life because of the struggles that I've gone through. Because had I not been at that low point in my life and been who I was at that time, our paths never would have crossed.
Yeah.
And we are fortunate that we have gone through this struggle together and we have overcome it. And I'm now in a happy and healthy relationship and my life is stable and I'm happy with it. So
I'm glad.
I am too. It's really made it worth it.
That's good. That's so good. You know, as I was preparing for this testimony and this story time with you, I kept thinking about Ephesians 3:16-19. If you don't mind, I'm going to read that.
Go ahead.
And it says, "Then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God." So knowing that depth of love and knowing that at one time it was hard for you to accept love because you didn't think that you were worth love, what would you say now? Is it hard to accept that kind of love, that never-ending, high as the heavens, as low as the depths, love that God offers us now?
I think it's something that I'm still working on. A lot of my life is a work in progress, as I'm sure it will continue to be.
Yes.
But I grow a little more and I learn a little more every day. And that's what's important, I think. The struggle isn't over. And I don't think that, for me at least, it ever will be. There's always another hurdle and another challenge to overcome. And I think that as long as I'm getting a little better each day, that I'm succeeding in that. So I'm happy with where I'm at. And I'm excited to see where I'll end up because of the progress that I'm making.
I'm very excited to see where you end up. And I can definitely see God's hand on you through the midst of all of this. And if you're listening and you're going through this, I just want you to know that there is hope, that you're not alone. Just as Halen has shared her testimony, you don't have to go through this alone, that God has placed people around you that can help you through this journey. And thank you so much, Halen, for being vulnerable, for sharing your story. And I truly believe that it can be the beginning of healing for someone else.
I hope that it can. I was glad to be here, and thank you for having me.
It's our pleasure. Good night, everyone.